Good morning. Welcome to worship here at Goldston Methodist Church. I love the energy in the room, this buzz is moving around. I would say that either you're really happy to see each other, or the Holy Spirit is in our midst, or maybe both. It's both. So welcome to worship here on April the 23rd here at Goldston Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Kerry Wood. We have a baptism today, which is a big reason why there's so much energy in the room, because we've got a lot of family here to celebrate as Lily Catherine Burke is going to be baptized, welcomed into the family of Jesus Christ. And so that's going to be happening this morning. Our kids are singing this morning, and I'm preaching this morning. You don't have to get excited about that, but all the rest of it, let's really get excited about. So I wanted to let you all know, on your bulletin, there is a prayer slip. Any praise or concern that you would like to share, you can use that slip, tear it out, and put it into the basket. A basket is going to go through the room during the first hymn, and you can put your prayer in there. We will then share those prayers later on in the worship service. If it is a prayer that you want me to read aloud and distribute, there's a check mark place for that. If you want it to be distributed at the end of the service, but you don't want me to read it aloud, you can check mark that. Or if it's only for me that you want me to be aware of a situation, then you can check mark that as well. So we're so good to have all of that happening. I want a couple of other announcements to share with you. First of all, we are continuing with our J.S. Waters Fuel Up as our April mission focus. And so the drop a dollar here when we kids come together, that's for the J.S. Waters Fuel Up. If you would like to make additional contributions to that, you are certainly welcome to do so. And this is a way to help kids that are part of J.S. Waters School have food when they're not at school. It's surprising how much food insecurity there exists in Chatham County, and this is a way for us to help with that issue. Also want to let you know that next Sunday is our second time to gather as the Siler City District of the Global Methodist Church. We had a whole bunch of folks that came to the first event back in February, and we're having the next one this coming Sunday, a week from today, at Mount Vernon Methodist Church, and yours truly is going to be preaching, but don't let that make you stay away. So let's come and be a part of that. That'll be at 5 p.m., and there will be a fellowship meal following the service. So please put that on your calendars and make that a part of your excitement of next Sunday. But there's somebody who has some excitement today as well. I understand somebody has a birthday this morning. Where is Sherry? There. Oh, yeah, she's in the choir, of course. I'm looking for you out there. So let's all sing happy birthday to Ms. Sherry Elmore. Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday to Sherry, happy birthday to you. Amen. And for good measure, Craig's was yesterday. Yeah, so they like to keep it close in the Elmore family. My friends, it is a glorious day. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship as we listen to the chimes and the prelude. Thank you. Amen. Would you stand as you're able and join in our singing of the call to worship, Majesty. Join me in the opening prayer. Lord of all creation, too often we live as if Jesus became irrelevant when he ascended into heaven. We act as though we are in charge of all things. Remind us today that Jesus is still King of kings and Lord of lords. Help us to give ourselves to him fully, completely, and without reservation, so that your life will fill us with joy and praise. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now let us sing our hymn of praise, This Is My Father's World. You may be seated. As the choir is exiting down, I invite Hayden and Jesse and Lily to come up and join me here on the steps. Friends, today is an historic day for Goldston Methodist Church because this is, to my knowledge, the first baptism that we are going to be doing as a global Methodist congregation. And so what that means is that there's a little bit of difference in the liturgy and the approach that we're going to be taking to celebrating her baptism this morning. So I'm going to take just a moment to explain to you what we are doing with this holy time. Through holy baptism, we are united in Christ's death in repentance of our sins, raised to new life in Him through the power of the resurrection, incorporated into the body of Christ, and empowered through the work of the Holy Spirit to go on towards perfection. Now, there's a whole sermon series just in those statements right there. Holy baptism is God's gracious gift to us, flowing from the once for all work of Jesus Christ and our pledge to follow Him as His disciples. Holy baptism may be performed by sprinkling, which is where you just drop the water on, pouring, where you pour it over, or by immersion, where you put the whole body in and get them fully soaked. The outward and visible sign of holy baptism is water. Candidates are baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit in response to Jesus' instructions in Matthew chapter 28, verse 19. The inward and spiritual grace is death to sin and a new birth to righteousness by faith through union with Christ in His death and resurrection. Holy baptism is administered among a gathered congregation. This is a communal event. Those present vow on behalf of Christ's holy church to receive the baptized into the church universal, to grow together in grace, and to remember the profession made and the benefits received in holy baptism. Candidates for baptism, whether they are unable to answer for themselves, shall be instructed in the Christian faith and the meaning of holy baptism as they grow older. Holy baptism is the initiation into Christ's holy church, and it occurs once in a person's life. Holy communion serves as the regular and the continual affirmation of our baptismal vows within the church. Through a service of baptismal remembrance and reaffirmation of our baptismal vows, we can renew the covenant that was declared at our own baptisms. So as we baptize little Lily, I'm going to invite you to remember your baptism, not necessarily remembering exactly what happened and when it happened, but remembering that Jesus has claimed each and every one of us. And so now I'm going to ask Hayden and Jesse, in faithfulness with early Christian practice as well as our Wesleyan tradition, those receiving the sacrament of holy baptism within the Global Methodist Church are asked these questions. Do you renounce the devil and all his works and reject the evil powers of this world? Do you repent of your sin, turn to Jesus Christ, and confess Him as your Lord and Savior? Do you receive and profess the Christian faith as contained in the Holy Scriptures of the Old and the New Testaments? Will you obediently keep God's holy will and commandments and walk in them all the days of your life by the grace and the power of God? And will you nurture this little one here, dear Lily, in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith in Him openly, and to lead a Christian life? My friends, I'm going to ask you to commit your support to this child in faith. Will you who witness these vows encourage this family in the faith and do all in your power to support Lily and her parents and everybody in this whole extended clan in their life in Christ? My friends, let us profess and our faith together. Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ? I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now we will have a prayer of thanksgiving over the water. If you want to take this. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And with your spirit. You got to read the prompt, friends. We're in the Global Methodist Church. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give our thanks to our Lord, our God. We do give thanks to you, Almighty and Everlasting Father, and we praise you for your infinite goodness and mercy. Above all, we thank you for your most dearly beloved Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. As he hung upon the cross for the forgiveness of our sins, from his side flowed both water and blood for the healing and cleansing of the world. After his resurrection, he commanded his disciples to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. You may now pour the water, Jesse. We ask that you now sanctify this water by the power of your Holy Spirit. Grant that Lily will be cleansed from all sin and receive the fullness of your grace, that she may ever remain faithful in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now we're going to sing in the middle of the baptism. That's different. What we're going to do is we're going to sing Jesus in Earth and Heaven the Same. This is something that was written by Charles Wesley, and for some reason, it's never been in any of our hymnals. But it's sung to the same tune as Hosanna, Loud Hosanna, that you should be used to when we sing that for Palm Sunday. Da, 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 da. So this will be the song tune to the words you see on the screen. Beth, I apologize. I gave you a typo. It's not a thin, unceasing prayer. It's thine unceasing prayer. The E makes all the difference. Come here, Lily. Come see me. Hi there. I'm not dead, am I?
No.
Lily Catherine, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Having been born of water and the Spirit, may you ever be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. Wow, you did awesome. Let's come out here and meet some of these friends. Yeah. Can you say hi to them? Yeah. These folks are all here to remember your baptism, even though you're not going to remember this. And they're taking videos so you can even watch yourself and go, I was that little one day? But all these folks are going to be here to love you, to care for you, to support you. And you get the chance to love and care and support all of them. Because that's what it means to be a disciple of Jesus, to be a part of God's family. You've got all kinds of friends, kids that are close to your age, and adults that are way older than you. But that's what it means to be in the love of Jesus, is to be a part of multiple generations, to be a part of the experience of passing on the faith. And that's what we're doing today. We are giving you the chance to know Jesus just like we know Jesus. And that is a really amazing, wonderful thing. Let us say a prayer. If I can get it out here. Oh God, our Heavenly Father, grant that Lily, as she grows in years, may also grow in grace and in the knowledge of and relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ, and that by the restraining and renewing influence of the Holy Spirit, she may ever be a true child of yours, serving you faithfully all her days. So guide and uphold these parents, that by loving care, wise counsel, and holy example, they may lead Lily into that life of faith, whose strength is righteousness and whose fruit is everlasting joy and peace. We pray through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. My friends, would you join me in the response to welcome Lily as the newly baptized member of Christ Holy Church? We welcome you and receive you into the fellowship of Goldston Methodist Church. We promise to surround you in a community of love and forgiveness as you grow in Christ, so that you may confess the faith of Christ crucified, proclaim his resurrection, and share with us in the royal priesthood of all God's people, to the glory of his name. Amen. Now, Lily grabbed the papers when we met last week as well, so maybe she's going to grow up to be an editor. Let us praise God. Will you celebrate her? You may return to your seats. My friends, it doesn't get much better than that, does it? Now I invite the kids to come down for children's time.
Thank you. question for you, though. Who is the King of Glory? Does anybody know who that is? Who is that? Jesus, that's right. Does everybody know that? That the King of Glory is Jesus? He, and what do you, when you think of kings, what do you think of? What do you think of a king? What is a king like? Boys. Hey, boys. When you think of a king, what do you think of? You think of rich, okay? What else do you think of? Do you think maybe he, what do you think, Adam? Gold, okay. Do you think of a king as strong? Yeah. Do you think of a king as mighty? Yeah. Do you think of a king who is always with you?
Yeah.
Maybe? Okay, so I'm going to read a little bit, and then I'm going to stop, and I want you to listen. The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need. He lets me rest in green meadows, and he leads me beside peaceful streams. I want you to close your eyes, and I want you to picture a green pasture and some peaceful streams. You can picture that, right? Because we see that in our backyard all the time. Okay, now open your eyes. He renews my strength. Can you make big muscles? Can you make big muscles? Okay, I got a few muscles. Okay, so God gives you peace, and God gives you strength. He guides me along right paths, bringing honor to his name. Even when I walk through the darkest valley, I will not be afraid, for you are close beside me. So that means that when God, when you are afraid, I want you to think of something when you're, when are you really afraid? Is there a time when you're afraid? Yes, at nighttime. So sometimes we're scared of nightmares or scary dreams. What about the dark? Can you cover your eyes and make it dark? Are you scared of the dark? Some of you might not be, but I know two that are. So whenever you're scared of something, you can always remember that who's with you?
Jesus.
Jesus is with you because he's your king. Okay? And then I want us to think about this. I'm going to skip over. It says, my cup overflows with blessings, and surely your goodness and unfailing love will pursue me all the days of my life. And I will live in the house of the Lord forever. Can you make a house with your hands? What is it talking about? Whose house?
My heart.
Okay, well, yes. And the Lord is with you in your house always. But what happens when you live your life and you pass away? What happens then? Where do you go?
In heaven.
You go into heaven. So the house of the Lord is talking about heaven going. Well, no, we don't want that. We want to go to heaven, right? Because we believe in Jesus. That's what we want. Okay, so I want you to remember that Jesus promised us that he will always take care of us. And whenever we are afraid, who is with us? If you can see me touch your nose, boys in the back. What did I just say? If you are afraid, who is with you?
God.
Okay, I want you to remember that. Let's pray. Everybody bow your head. Dear God.
Dear God.
Help us remember. That you are the King.
That you are the King.
And you're always close to us.
And you're always close to us.
Even when we're afraid.
Even when we're afraid.
In Jesus' name, amen.
In Jesus' name.
Thank you much, boys and girls. It's great to have so many here. As we move now into our time of prayer, we have a couple that we want to specifically remember in prayer this morning. First of all, prayers for Barry Gaines, who's dealing with cancer, and also for Charles Fuquay, who is dealing with cancer. So we pray that God will bring healing upon both of these gentlemen. Are there other praises or joys or concerns that you would like to share that didn't get a chance to put it on a slip?
Okay.
Pray for Kim's mom.
Hi there, Bruce.
Yes, ma'am.
I'd like to thank everybody in the church. The cards I got, get a card. It means a lot here to get a card if you're down and can't get out. Well, your home, or one of your homes, it means an extra lot more to know that people are thinking about. And I got a lot of cards from different ones here. Some of them sent home the card. And I just want to thank everybody for it. It's been a lot to me.
Amen. It's a great way to express our love for one another. Yes, ma'am.
It's a blessing that today is our grandson Tucker's 21st birthday. He's doing prayers at the Muscular Dystrophy is making him weaker.
Okay.
He's just as happy as he can be, and he's going to an NC State baseball game.
Well, that's exciting news. We do pray for him. Absolutely. Let's take these things that are on our lips and that which is in our hearts, and let us take a few moments for silent prayer. Holy God, what a beautiful, beautiful morning it is today. Both in terms of the glorious sunshine after all of the storms of yesterday, but even more for the sunshine that exists here in this room by the enthusiasm of our children, by the excitement of a baptism, by the gathering of family and friends to celebrate who we are as the followers of Jesus. Lord, in all these things, we are truly grateful. And Lord, we pray for those that are among us in spirit but can't be here in person. For those that are dealing with illnesses and diseases. For those that are recovering from surgeries. For those that are in another place, another location, and maybe they want to be there on a vacation or maybe they don't want to be there because they're stuck. But whatever the situation, whatever the case may be, we lift them up into your hands. And God, we ask that you would come down upon us, that we would feel the power of your Holy Spirit, that we would recognize that we have a King who reigns, and that we can truly trust in your kingship, trust in your grace. And Lord, may this be reflected not only in what we do in this hour of worship, but what we do in all the hours of our day. And we pray this remembering the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Our scripture reading for today is from Psalms 24, 7 through 10. Lift up your heads, you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, you gates, lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is he, this King of glory? The Lord Almighty, he is the King of glory. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Carrie. Would you pray with me? O Spirit of the living God fall fresh upon us all. Still our hearts, our minds, that we may rejoice that the Lord is King. In his name we pray, amen. So today is the second message in a series talking about the ascension of Jesus, the importance of Jesus not only being born, which is what we celebrate at Christmas, not only Jesus giving himself up for us, which we celebrate on Maundy, Thursday, and Good Friday as Jesus dies on the cross for our sins, not only for Jesus' resurrection on the third day, that Sunday morning, Easter, that we celebrated just a couple of weeks ago. Those are all very valid and very important aspects of Jesus' life, but there's one other thing that most of the time we pay zero attention to at all, and that is the ascension of Jesus. And so this month and into May, we're moving towards Ascension Sunday. And then that will lead us into Pentecost Sunday. Now, normally I would not wear this stole until Pentecost Sunday, because this is a Holy Spirit Pentecost stole. But it also happens to be a baptism stole, and so I wanted to be able to honor and celebrate with Lily and to recognize that it is only because Jesus ascended that the Holy Spirit then came down so that Christ's presence could be with all of us all the time, as that famous movie said, everywhere, everything, all at once. So Jesus being ascended into heaven means that Jesus is the King. Now we ask the kids, what do you think of when you think of a king? So let me ask you, adults, what do you think of when you think of a king? We don't have many kings around these days. It used to be that there were kings everywhere. But now probably the one that we think of as king the most is the one who in just a few more weeks is going to officially be coronated as king, which is King Charles, King of England, Wales, Scotland, and Northern Ireland. But did you know that King Charles is not the first King Charles? He's actually the third King Charles. And I'm going to show you a picture of both King Charles II and King Charles III. And I want you to tell me, what do you see as the differences between these two kings? Go ahead and show us that picture, Freddie. King Charles II is the one who has got this big flowing robe, and he's holding the scepter, and he's got the orb. And then King Charles III is just wearing all of his medals and sitting relaxed in a chair. Now, which picture of the king conveys the most regal and majesty? Charles II or Charles III? Now, Charles II, he's intending to impress you.
I am the king. Hear me roar.
And when King Charles was king, King Charles II, that is, when he roared, people would jump. They would do the things that the king told them to do because he had power. King Charles III, how much power does he really have? Have you watched The Crown? Now, granted, that is a fictional depiction of the British royal family, but there are germs of truth in it, and King Charles has spent his entire life waiting for this moment, but because he had to wait so long, I mean, who would have thought that his mother would have lived so long and reigned for so long? As a result, we don't know how much authority King Charles III will actually have, because over time, the kings and queens of England have given most of their political power away. They've given away most of their religious power. Did you know that the King of England is the head of the Church of England? But yet, when he is confirmed on his throne on May 4th, whatever that day is, He's not going to have any real political power. He's not going to have any real religious power. The only economic power he has is just the great amount of wealth that the crown has amassed through the centuries. But even there, he's kind of limited in what he can and cannot do. And if this is our mentality of what a king is like, when we talk about Jesus as king, it's like, oh, yeah, okay, cool. And it makes no difference. But it should. Because the kingdom of Jesus is part of this unseen real. Jesus is indeed alive and reigning. Let's go ahead and see the next slide there, Freddie. We think of Jesus as the king, and we want to put him on the stained glass window and say, oh, isn't that beautiful? But my friends, we need to be doing more than just looking at a picture in a stained glass window. And realizing that when Jesus is king and we describe Jesus as reigning, that it's more than just a pretty picture. It is a reality. And it is a reality that should make a difference in our own realities. Let's go ahead and go to the next slide, Freddie. As we think about this, think about what we say in the Apostles' Creed. We said that in the middle of the baptism. Let me remind you of those words. We say Jesus was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven. What do all those verbs have in common? They're past tense. That's what Jesus did. It's done, it's over, it's accomplished, boom. But then the very next part of the Apostles' Creed, it says this, where he sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. What is the tense of that verb? Yes. Thank you, sixth grade English. Jesus is not just in the past. He is in the now. He sits at the right hand of God, the right hand of God the Father Almighty. That's where he is right now. And it's where he will come when he comes again to earth. But here's the funny thing about the next part when it says he will come back to earth. Actually, Jesus is already here, but only in the unseen reality. And since the Enlightenment, we have been taught by a European way of thinking to only consider things that are real, the things that our five senses will tell us are real. If you can see it, if you can hear it, if you can touch it, if you can taste it, if you can smell it, then it's real. And if you can't do any of those things, then obviously it cannot be real. But here's the funny thing. Because God will do things that can be seen, and we're still likely not to want to believe. Deborah and I were at a conference a little over a year ago. And in this conference, we had a speaker who was speaking about different things, and then at the end of the speaker, he offered an invitation for people to come forward and to be prayed for, to be prayed over. And one of the things he specifically said is if you are feeling some kind of physical ailment, come and be prayed for. I believe that God is ready to do a miracle in our midst tonight. And so we gathered together, and many people came down to the front. They started praying, and there was one guy who walked down, and he walked down with a limp. And they started praying for him. And as they prayed, he started swaying, and he wasn't able to hold himself up. And so they grabbed a chair, and he sat down in the chair, and they continued to pray for him. And in the process of the praying, his feet, his legs, which one was slightly shorter than the other, and for years and years and years and years, he had suffered with one leg slightly shorter than the other, which gave him that limp. And as they prayed, his legs became equal. Now, how many of you believe that story? There's a lot of skepticism because you didn't see it with your own eyes. I'll be honest with you, there's a lot of skepticism for me because I saw with my own eyes, but I didn't actually see the foot do that. But I saw him walk down with a limp, and I saw him walk back without a limp. The unseen real of Jesus as King can be made visibly real when we are willing to open ourselves up and experience that power coursing through us. Now, there are several different spheres and ways in which Jesus as the reigning King should be recognized by us. Let's look at that next slide, Freddie. The dimensions of Christ's reign are the personal, the communal, the social, and the global. I'm going to take just a moment to explain what I mean by each of these things. The personal dimension of Christ's reign, that means you and I, we need to have a personal acknowledgement that Jesus is King over me. How many of you have seen the bumper sticker, "God is my co-pilot"? It's been around a long time. Did you know that that sticker is absolutely 100% wrong? If God is your co-pilot, somebody's sitting in the wrong seat. God should be the pilot. At best, we're the flight attendant. If we're trying to do anything else, if we're trying to take hold of those controls, then we are not acknowledging that Jesus is King, that Jesus is Lord. There was a song that came out a number of years ago called "Jesus Take the Wheel." Do y'all remember that one? That song also had a problem. I mean, at least she got it right, "Jesus Take the Wheel," but the problem was that she started driving and got herself in trouble in the first place. And then she says, "Jesus, take the wheel." My friends, we baptized Lily this morning because we want Jesus taking her wheel right now. We've got so many children in our church these days because, thank the Lord, we've got parents who want their children to know Jesus is real and he needs to be in their lives. So those of us in this room, let's take that lesson and let Jesus really be our King. Trust in him and let him be the guiding force in your life. How do you do that? Well, number one is you got to pray regularly, read your scriptures regularly, gather with other Christians regularly, and then the power of the Holy Spirit will come upon us, and we will know what to do, what not to do. I firmly believe that we had our first baptism as a global Methodist church this morning is because people in Goldston said, we want to listen to Jesus and follow him, and that's what you did. I wound up here in Goldston, North Carolina, because I wanted to follow Jesus, and somehow somebody in Ohio started talking to somebody in North Carolina, and my name came up. I had nothing to do with it, but I firmly believe that Jesus did, and I thank God every day when I wake up in Goldston. That is the personal dimension of Christ's reign. There's also the communal dimension of Christ's reign, and this is describing the church. We as the church need to recognize that God is over us. Do you know this church belongs to Jesus? It doesn't belong to me. It doesn't belong to the administrative council chair. It doesn't belong to the lay leader. Sorry, Britt. It belongs to Jesus. Hear what Paul says to the church in Ephesians chapter 1. It says, God placed all things under his, meaning Jesus, under Jesus' feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church. Isn't it interesting? It's not in the church. It's for the church. That means that all the power, all the authority, everything that Jesus has is for us, which means Jesus is quite capable of taking care of his church without us trying to take care of it for him. But too often we do. Too often we begin to think about it. Well, this is our church budget. This is our property. This is our mission program. This is our this, that, or the other. Or worse, in some cases, this is my this or my that. No. The church is his. And we as a church need to recognize that. So even if the Holy Spirit says, okay, Goldston, you need to take your bank account and you need to empty it because I'm going to do an amazing thing for you. Our human reaction to that would be, what? No. We got to take care of business. But if God says to do it, we got to trust that if God says empty your bank account, that all we're doing is just getting ready for a bigger account to come in our midst. That's the trust of his kingship coming in. The social dimension of Christ's reign, this has to do with politics. Did you know that Jesus is not a Republican? Did you know that Jesus is not a Democrat? Did you know that Jesus is not a communist or a capitalist? Jesus is not an American or a Russian or a Chinese or any other of our various nation states. Jesus is king over humanity. And whenever we try to take Jesus and pigeonhole him into being only the Republican Savior or only the Democrat Savior, we are not letting him be our king. Do you know why politics is so ugly these days? Because we've said, Jesus, you don't matter. And so we've gotten ourselves all caught up in fear-based politicking. Now, I'm talking about any part of American politics right now. Don't say that, oh, he's talking about only the one side or only the other side. I'm talking about, in general, we look at politics out of a fear-based situation. We try to evoke fear and say, if you don't vote for my guy, then all hell is going to break loose. And then when the other guy gets elected, or gal, I'll be honest and fair, and that's not my party, oh, hell's all going to break loose. Did you know that Jesus has conquered sin and hell? Even if hell tries to break loose, Jesus can contain it if we will let him be king. And finally, there's this global dimension. Think about this in terms of cars. Where did cars first get their start? Anybody know? Germany. Did you know the diesel engine gets its name from a guy named Diesel? I didn't until I was reading a book this week. Where did cars get their start in the United States? Oh, come on, you guys know your history. Detroit! The home of Henry Ford and Carl B. Smith, I think, General Motors head. Today, we drive cars from Korea, cars from Germany. Sometimes we even drive cars from England. But where do cars really come from these days? Mexico. That's where most of them are built. The car has become an international product. Parts and pieces are made in different parts of the world. They all come together, they get assembled, and then they get sold, again, all over the world. So it used to be that, oh, I have to be loyal to Mercury. Well, Mercury doesn't exist anymore. Or I've got to be loyal to Pontiac. Well, Pontiac doesn't exist anymore. So when we get too loyal to a certain brand, a certain product, and we forget that it's a part of a much bigger picture, we lose out. There's getting ready to be a Vietnamese electric car company building their cars here in North Carolina, not very far away from where we're sitting right now, right? How many of you are interested in driving a Vietnamese car made in North Carolina? I am, if I can afford it. If it's got enough range to let me get where I need to go. My friends, Jesus is much better than an internationally made car because Jesus is the King over all the earth, over all the globe. And if we let ourselves get blinded by nationalistic sentimentality, we're again losing the kingship of Christ. When Jesus gave his instructions to the disciples, he said, "Go into all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit." When he said, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." And you think you don't know Scripture. My friends, this is what the kingdom of God is all about. It starts with us individually, and it goes out in concentric circles and waves, just like when the turtles jump into the pond. There's got to be at least 50 turtles living in this pond over here. And Deborah and I get the joy of watching them. There was one that was a great big daddy of a turtle. I got a picture of it. I didn't try to touch it. I've been told these are snapping turtles. And his mouth looked big enough that if I put my finger out there, I might not get the finger anymore. How did that big turtle get to be so big? Because he lived in the environment where he gave his all to living in that environment. My friends, we can become big turtles by trusting in Jesus and acknowledging him as our King. Not some king up somewhere far, far away, but King right here, right now. He reigns. Say that back. He reigns. With enthusiasm, he reigns. Hallelujah. Amen. One of the ways in which we express the reigning of Christ over us is through giving God control of our pocketbooks and our checking accounts and everything else where we park our money. And so we gather together for worship, and we gather together to receive the offering, to give to God, because God is so richly given to us. Will the ushers help serve as we gather the offering for today? Thank you. Please stand for the doxology. God, we give these gifts to you, recognizing that actually these only are ours because they first came from you. And so, Lord, we are returning to you what you have so graciously given to us. And may this be just a part of our overall commitment of everything that we are, everything that we have, to be put into service for our King Jesus, who died, rose again, and ascended to heaven, where he sits at your right hand as the King over us all. In his great and wonderful name we pray. Amen. Let us sing our closing praise. It is, Rejoice, the Lord is King. My friends, if you would like to dive even deeper into what it means for Jesus to be reigning as our King, you're invited to come this Wednesday at 6 p.m. for a meal, followed by Bible study at 6:45. Come and be a part of that as we look at what it means to follow Jesus. But if you don't come on Wednesday, as you walk out this morning, or afternoon, thank you for bearing with me, remember, Jesus is your King, personally, communally, socially, globally. He reigns. Amen.